Hi, so nice to see everyone. For those of you who don't know me, so I'm Evan Barba. I'm a professor at Georgetown University and I guess like the ringmaster of this 13-ring circus that we've created. I just want to thank you all for being here, for coming and joining us for RSD12. As I'm sure you know, it is an incredible undertaking. I don't think there's really any precedence for what we've tried to do here. And if you know of any, like, please don't mention them because, like, it's 9 months too late for that at this point. But it's not really an exaggeration, actually, to say that because I think I was looking back at my calendar, and the first planning meeting that we had for RSD12 was back in January 24th. So it's almost going to be a full 10 months that we've been engaged in this planning. And I'm only 21, so that's a huge chunk of my life. But way back when we were beginning, we took a survey and we asked the RSD community what it was that they wanted to see in the next RSD event. And there were a few things that really jumped out at us. So one was that the Systemic Design Association, the body that has really overseen the development of this field. Oh, and by the way, if you are not a member of the SDA, you may want to think about joining. I will drop a link in the chat here. So there you go. You can join the SDA if you'd like. So the SDA wanted to make sure that RSD12 continued the big arc of growth that we've seen over the past decade. And I'm pleased to report that we had a record-breaking 358 submissions this year across all the categories. That's a 35% increase from last year and 157% over the year before. That is really like an amazing growth trajectory. And so clearly, systemic design is really growing quite strong. And I'm pleased that we were able to continue that trend. There is a downside to that, though. And I'm sad to report that we had a much lower acceptance rate this year of about 52% than we had in the past. And that's because we only had about 100 paper slots available to us in this format. We did our best to accommodate as many submissions as possible. And we worked quite diligently, I think, to find some really novel and interesting ways to include authors. One of the things that I've always appreciated about RSD, and I've been coming here, I think, since RSD4, right? One of the things that I found is that it's really a platform for many different kinds of work, many different kinds of ideas at different stages of their maturity. And we've really strived, I think, over the years to nurture scholars and practitioners at every point in their career. And I think we've really continued that tradition. Sadly, though, not everyone could be included this time around. And having been on the receiving end of unwelcome review decisions many times in my career, I can really empathize with the authors. And all I can say is that we are all fallible humans. Even reviewers, and there's no such thing as an optimal reviewing process. We did the best that we could, and I hope that those who could not be included at least got useful feedback, and are still joining us as attendees at RSD12. Nonetheless, though, I'm really quite proud, and in some ways a bit astonished at the program that we've managed to put together for you. So not only do we have over 100 research papers in the program, but we've also got over 150 total sessions. In a wide range of formats, including workshops that are both local and at the various hubs, online, also interactive discussions, salon panels, meet the author sessions for those publishing books related to systemic design, and these plain old hangouts that exist inside the Zoom events lobby. I haven't tried them yet, but they look pretty cool, so I'm really looking forward to seeing people there. So in general, like, I don't necessarily advocate staring at your screen all day and night, unless you're, but like maybe in this case, you might want to for the next 2 weeks. There's really quite an amazing array of content, and I'm really happy that we can offer it to you. However, if you're at a hub, I think it's better to probably go out and meet people and interact with them. And so, in that case, I think you should definitely favor your in-person interactions. About the hubs, right? This multi-hubs format is really like one of the most distinctive features of RSD12, I think. And I just want to take a minute to orient you towards the origins of that idea and some of the intentions behind that format. In addition to the SDA as a stakeholder, right? And once again, I'll put the link for the SDA membership into the chat so you can join if you'd like. In addition to the SEA, our other really big stakeholder for RSD is the community, right? And that's you. And the thing that you told us that you love the most about RSD was in fact yourselves. So I guess maybe you're all just a bunch of narcissists. I don't know. But seriously though, you said the community was actually the most important part of RSD to you. And you wanted more ways to join the community and you wanted to make sure that the RSD community stayed cozy, right? Where you could have engaging conversations and meet new people. And that's a pretty tall order, actually. So I think there's an inherent paradox in trying to keep things cozy, which means, you know, intimate and warm and small, and to also make them bigger and more wide reaching at the same time, right? And plus there are other parameters that we also tried to consider. So obviously the impact of travel and conferences on climate is a serious consideration. And I know that this community cares very deeply about those issues. And so if we weren't going to explore alternatives to the traditional conference format, then I wasn't really sure who would. And so part of the reason, the motivation behind this hubs experiment was to try and lighten our carbon footprint a little bit. Another consideration was the persistence of COVID, right? We learned from RSD 10 and RSD 9, which were both derailed by lockdowns, that living in an interconnected world means that we're all affected, right? All affected together. And plans can change very quickly. If we were to put it in different terms, I might say that we're actually sort of more entangled than we've ever been in history. And while I'm glad that we don't have to test this hypothesis, I actually think that the hubs format that we have here would be really quite adaptable and resilient to a wide range of disruptions, as long as someone else other than me is running it, probably. But there are other and more minor and I think, but still salient reasons for the hubs model, right? So for one, it always seemed a little weird to me that in the 21st century, academics still like to get together in like these small groups to present their work. And the only really persistent thing that comes out of that is the research paper, right? And so it just doesn't fit with the way that like content lives and exists these days. And so I'm really glad to say that actually all of the sessions from RSD 12 are being recorded and will be available on this platform at least until November 30th. So if you would like to check back in and show them to your class or offer them to your colleagues, that content will be available here until for at least another month. And I intend to try to make it available in perpetuity in some way long after that. So once again, so satisfying all of these sort of multidimensional constraints it's absolutely a wicked problem. And the format that we've created here was sort of our solution to that problem. So some people will attend RSD 12, like specifically at one of our hubs. And you know, our hope for that is that you'll meet new people in your region, you can share your interests, you can incubate the next generation of systemic design projects together, or at the very least, you can just find some time and space to reconnect with your friends who you may not have a good reason to see otherwise. We also hope that people who can't travel for whatever reason will still be able to have shared experiences with those who are remotely connected, and that those experiences will help them build rapport and camaraderie together and be touchstones for new relationships that can continue for other RSDs. You know, we also do hope that our carbon footprint is lower than it has been in the past. I think less travel means less of an environmental impact, and hopefully we can continue to keep reducing our carbon footprint as well as the cost for attending, right? So all of the content on the RSD 12 online platform only costs $50. And in many cases, we were able to even get that lower for people. And that I think is a real benefit to doing things this way. I also just hope that you'll be exposed to things that you wouldn't be exposed to otherwise because of the wide ranging access that you have on this platform. And so when I say that, that we hope for these things. Who am I talking about exactly? So as you can imagine, this is a huge undertaking and something that this complex really requires a small army to create it, right? And that means that everyone here is really a part of it, right? So attendees, authors, reviewers, speakers, moderators, our tech helpers who are here, the sketchnoters, all of our collective care is what holds this together. And I think it's really actually worth taking a moment right now and just sort of looking around at what we've created, because I think this is a really wondrous thing that we've done together. So just take a moment. And while you're doing that, there are really two people whose blood, sweat, and tears have made this possible more than the others. One of them is my amazing assistant, Alyssa Zarno. Ella is actually my lab manager, and I hired her back around March or April into that position. And one day she let it slip that she had experience with event planning, and her life has been total chaos ever since then. She's gotten a lot more than she ever bargained for out of that job application. But I owe her a tremendous debt of gratitude. She's really like kept me sane and calm throughout most of this process, and I might not have made it without her. So thank you, Ella. I promise you can go back to managing equipment sometime soon, but not just yet. And the other person who brought us here needs absolutely no introduction. You know her from RSD9, from RSD10, from RSD11. She's in your social media. She's blown up your inbox for the last 3 months. And that is the tireless and talented Cheryl May. Cheryl, say hello. So if I've said it once, I've said it 1,000 times. I've never met anyone who can manage more complexity than Cheryl can. It's no wonder that she found our community. She's like clearly an organizational genius. And despite that, though, I do think, and she may not admit it, but I think RSD12 actually nearly broke her a couple times. So she's still here, though. She's still alive and kicking, and none of us would be here without her. So let's all just like collectively tap the applause emoji for Cheryl at this point. Her service to this community is really, it's truly the stuff of legend. So thank you, Cheryl. We all owe you for being here. Okay, so the very last thing that I want to talk about is just the theme of this conference, right? This notion of entanglements. So when Cheryl and Pulak Didani and I were brainstorming ideas for the theme, I had mentioned an article that I read about the holographic model of the universe. Which you can look up. I won't bore you with the details of the physics of it. But it really shifted our thinking towards like sort of this notion of it, that in physics, and that's sort of where the root of a lot of complexity research lies. And the concept of entanglement specifically just comes from quantum physics, right? It describes this phenomenon where two particles can maintain a connection despite being separated by time and space. One goes up, the other goes down, one goes left, the other goes right. And they influence each other from afar, right? And Einstein called this spooky action at a distance because it was ethereal and ghost-like to him. And I've really been heartened to see that the RSD community has embraced this idea, both like in its pure quantum physics definition and also as a metaphor for the kind of work that we do in systemic design. So in a pure sense, what I think we've tried to achieve here with RSD12 is to create this entanglement, right? To create an event where people can have real connection and real influence over each other from a wide distance. That may come naturally for something as small as a photon, but it's also no small feat for people, right? People are not so great at that. But yet it is still something that we do to each other, for each other, all the time in our really interconnected world this way. And I think it's important to take a minute and just think about the fact that we are really all entangled together. And that means something and it matters. And it means that your actions affect other people in ways that you may not be aware of. And so I'm hoping that RSD12 will be a way to experience that interconnectedness, to think about it and to reflect on it. And there are other connotations to the notion of entanglement that I think are also in play here. So for one, I've heard from many practitioners, design practitioners over the years that doing their job really well means becoming enmeshed and embedded and entangled in the groups that they work with. The communities of users that they serve, the communities in general that they serve, once they're really connected with those people, their needs become second nature to them. And that's a real motivating force in their design work. And it's also sometimes like even a source of sadness, right? Because they share the suffering of that group when things end up not going well. And on the research side, I've also talked to colleagues who will really sort of lament the fact that they are forced to be more objective and separate from the things that they study than they would like to be, right? So the reason they got into research was because they loved the topic, because they loved an idea. And when you're trained to do research, you're often trained to maintain a distance from that thing. And I think for a lot of people, that's been a source of like a real tension in their lives. And I've found that I think luckily, many people in research now are realizing that this objectivity is really just a myth, that in fact, we are entangled with the things that we study. And we need to actually be conscious of that and to reflect on it. Because otherwise, that's where bias can creep in if we don't think about it. And so in order for research to really be effective and to de-bias it, I think we need to be reflective about our own position in that process, and to think about how entangled we are in the things that we study, right? So this is all to say that entanglement is something that we all experience, both personally and professionally, and that despite some of the connotations around chaos and confusion that can come with that idea, that it's always something that we need to be aware of, and that we need to embrace sometimes. And so with that in mind, I would like to ask a favor of all of you. So we have marshaled a tremendous effort to create this program, to link up these 13 hubs, each of which also has committed tremendous resources to join us all together. But this network that we've built over the past 9 or 10 months now, it's inherently fragile, right? At some point, the hubs will wrap up their programs. The online content will eventually go sit somewhere where it's inert until someone comes to activate it. But before all of that happens, for the next 2 weeks, we have an opportunity to use this network in this sort of fragile and temporary form that it exists in right now as a scaffold to build new and lasting connections, right? And those connections, they're not going to be on Zoom events. They may start there. They're not going to be in an auditorium or a classroom somewhere. They're not going to be on one of like the 500 spreadsheets that have RSD12 in the title at this point. Those connections are going to be present in us, right? They're going to be present in our human interactions, in our experience together. And I think if we dedicate ourselves to creating those interactions over the next 2 weeks, then I think we'll ultimately be quite successful, right? So really the favor that I'm asking of all of you is to entangle yourselves as deeply and completely as you can into this system that we've designed, so that when we all disentangle on October 21st and RSD12, you know, fades and RSD13 starts to move in to our consciousness, what I'm hoping is that the experience will lead to a more stable, a more impactful, and a more meaningful entanglement of human relationships that's much more persistent than the patchwork of hubs and digital platforms that have helped create it. Right. And so I think if we can all do that together, then I think we'll remember RSD12 as a milestone experiment in systemic design. And that's what I wanted to say to you today. Thank you all for being here and for joining us. This is really just the beginning of what I think is going to be an amazing journey. I look forward to seeing you at multiple sessions. And Tony Fry will be up next in just a few minutes. So I will give you guys some time to use the bathroom or get some coffee before his talk. And I'll stay here if you want to talk to me. So thank you all. So nice to see you all.